Welcome to the first in a series of three videos centered around the basics for using Emagic's Logic Audio. My name is Phil Jackson, and over the next 40 minutes, I'll show you how to set up Logic Audio for maximum use and creativity. The video is constructed around the making of an autolode song or template that will always be ready whenever you want to make music. This includes the setting up of instruments, multi, mapped, and custom instruments, the metronome, screen sets, and the user-definable key commands. So let's do it. Logic Audio is a real-time, non-destructive, object-oriented sequencer, which simply means that as you record and compose music, you'll create these objects or sequences in the work area of the Arrange window. The Arrange window also consists of the track list, the real-time non-destructive playback parameters, the toolbox, and the instrument parameters. A transport window can either float on top of the Arrange window or be viewed in the top left-hand corner. At the top of the Arrange window is the bar ruler. The song position line follows this linear view of your composition. To record MIDI in Logic, simply select a track. Click and hold on the icon and choose an instrument from the instrument flip menu. Check that you've got MIDI through, then press record or the asterisk key. When you've finished recording, hit stop, hit it again to return to the top of the song, and then hit play. With the object recorded, you can pick it up and move it, hold down a modifier and copy it, adjust its length, loop it, and quantize it, all without stopping the music. You build up your composition by recording more MIDI tracks and manipulating those objects. This is covered in more detail in Volume 2, Recording and Editing MIDI. Once you've laid down the basic groove, go to the track mixer and record enable an audio track. Name the file and save it to your hard disk. After getting a good level, go back to the Arrange window and hit record. When you hit stop, the overview will be calculated. Take the track out of Record Ready directly from the Arrange window, and then press play. Just like a MIDI sequence, an audio region can be edited non-destructively directly from the Arrange window. After zooming in, grab the ends of the region to change the in and the out points. You can also loop, move, and copy an audio region. Let's take a listen. Build up the audio tracks just like we did with MIDI. Audio is covered in more detail in Volume 3, Recording Audio. Adjust the levels of the mix using the track mixer. I've been using and demonstrating Logic Audio to musicians all over the world for the last 6 years, and it's a phenomenal piece of software. But to get to the point where using Logic Audio feels as comfortable as, say, surfing the internet, you need to master the basics. What you're about to watch will give you enough knowledge to really get you started in harnessing its awesome power. Before proceeding with anything else, we should check that Logic Audio is properly configured for the audio hardware you're using. From the Audio menu, choose Audio Hardware and Drivers. Logic will have checked only the appropriate drivers for the installed hardware. Currently, Logic Audio is configured for 16 buses and a maximum of 32 physical audio tracks. Increasing the track count does require more RAM, but usually between 24 and 32 tracks should suffice for most people's sessions. Logic is set up for 8 ins and 8 outs, as well as 16-bit recording. We're also monitoring the record signal through the card, hence a small buffer size of 0.125, about 4 milliseconds. If you find there's too much input latency due to either computer speed or the audio hardware won't permit, turn the option off and monitor the signal directly from the mixing console. The slower the hard disk, the slower the head seek times are. This is important when playing back many audio tracks. A larger disk buffer does require more memory for each track played back, but Logic will buffer 1 second of audio versus its usual half second. Use this option only if the hard disk you own is a fast one, like the 9GB Glyph drive. If you're not sure what to choose, experiment both ways to see how the performance feels. A larger processor buffer is similar to the disk buffer, but specific to real-time processing. You get more overall DSP calculations when enabled. The trade-off is less processing power to other areas of the program. Again, experimentation is key. More friendly disk read handling should only be enabled if you're running more than one audio system simultaneously. For example, an Emagic Audio Work 8 and a DigiDesign 001. This option helps to balance the retrieval of audio files from the hard disk when the two audio systems are accessing the same disk. If the two audio systems have their own dedicated hard disk, you can keep this turned off. The Universal Track Mode option, when checked, allows each audio object to be freely configured for playing back either mono, stereo interleaved, or split stereo files. With Universal Track Mode switched on, this split stereo file uses one track and one audio object. With Universal Track Mode turned off, the split stereo file uses two tracks and two audio objects. When the stereo selector is activated within the mixer, the even-numbered channels become blank. This is because they're now controlled by the odd channels. Because DigiDesign's DAE cannot play stereo interleave files, the Universal Track Mode option is not available with DAE. The Communications Preference window is where you tell Logic Audio specifics about the way your MIDI system works. From the Options menu, choose MIDI Interface Communication. The window looks like this. On the PC, MIDI interfaces are usually connected via USB or serial or by a PCI card installed inside the CPU. If you've installed the software that came with your MIDI interface, then Logic Audio should already be configured and your MIDI system ready for use. You connect MIDI interfaces to the Mac via one or all of the available ports, modem, printer, or USB. These ports work completely independent of each other. Finally, AMT, or Active MIDI Transmission, is for Emagic's proprietary Active MIDI timing system. The Yanada 8 Mark II is an AMT-compatible interface. You definitely want this turned on if you own one of these. When you first boot Logic Audio on either platform, the default song is open. This default song is automatically configured for a simple General MIDI studio. On the PC, the configuration is set up for one General MIDI device, while on the Macintosh, the configuration is set up for two, and is a combination of single instruments and multi-instruments. There are 9 basic screen sets already configured. 1 is the Arrange window. 2 is the Event List Editor. 3 is the Score window. And 4 is the Audio window. 5 is the Hyper Editor. Now, the Hyper Editor looks identical to the Arrange window when there's no music in your song. 6 is the Matrix Editor. 7 is an Environment window. 8 is the Track Mixer. And 9, another Environment window. Logic Audio pre-configures and builds a mixer based on the audio hardware you have installed. If we press number 9 on the default song, the Environment window, we can see the pre-configured audio objects. Track objects for playing back audio files, followed by audio instrument objects for synth or sampler plugins, bus objects or returns for effects and submixing, and finally to the master output or master faders. The Autoload song is a starting point for all future songs that you'll create with Logic. It's the Autoload song that you customize with your virtual studio and your screen set configurations. It's what makes composing, recording, editing and mixing effortless. There are many environment templates that you can use to customize your Autoload song. There are templates available for mixers, synth editors, analog drum editors, and many more. Many of these templates have been put together by dedicated Logic users all over the world. These templates are all available on the support CD that came with Logic Audio. There's also plenty to be found on the web for downloading. For the Autoload song to function properly, it must be placed in the same directory or folder as the Logic Audio application. With a default untitled song open, I'll choose Save As from the main file menu. In the Open and Save dialog, I'll navigate the hard disk to locate the Logic Audio directory. Again, the Autoload song must be saved here. After naming the file Autoload, I'll click the Save button, and we're now ready to begin customizing the Autoload song. The thing to remember here is setting up your custom Autoload template should be practical and fun to do. Give thought to the sound sources you have available in your studio. What are the patches you tend to reach for first when composing or producing music? What are the MIDI editors you're most comfortable using? With the default song saved as Autoload, the first order of business is setting up your instruments. This is done in the environment. Open the environment from the Arrange window either by double-clicking the icon in the track list or by choosing Open Environment from the main Windows menu. Each Logic song has only one environment, but it's organized into layers. Feel free to create or delete layers as you need them. If you'd like to insert a layer before an existing one, say this one, MIDI Instruments, use the Insert Layer command found within the Environments Options menu. On the Macintosh, the Options menu is a local menu. To name the layer, simply double-click. Now, one very important environment layer is the global layer. Any object or instrument placed in the global layer will be visible in every other environment layer. The global layer, along with the all objects layer, cannot be deleted. Although the environment's possibilities are endless, the knowledge needed to set up your virtual studio couldn't be any easier. Let's begin by looking at the relationship between the environment window and the arrange window. All items created in the environment window are referred to as instruments or objects. Once created, they're immediately visible in the instrument flip menu here in the arrange window. Click and hold on the icon to access this menu. As I select different tracks in the track list, the multi-instrument changes to reflect which sub-channel is assigned to the selected track, even if that instrument or object is residing in a different layer of the environment. This is how Logic Audio works. Predefined instruments and objects are assigned to the tracks in the track list. If the multi-instrument is deleted, then any tracks assigned to that multi or any of its sub-channels will change to no output, meaning there is no longer an instrument assigned to the track, or tracks as is the case here. You'll also have no MIDI output or patch through. Let's delete everything from this layer. I'll go to the Edit menu, choose Select All, hit the Delete or Backspace key to clear the selection. Note that the instrument flip menu now has fewer items. When setting up instruments in Logic Audio, we deal with three types: instruments, multi-instruments, as mentioned before, and mapped instruments. Instruments can be named using either the eye tool located in the toolbox residing in the parameters here on the left, or with the first line of the instrument parameters. Simply click and name. These are the parameters here. If you don't see them, they could be hidden. Check the Hide Parameters option found within the View menu. These parameters are common throughout most of Logic Audio window types, but some windows, such as the Arrange or the Environment window, usually contain sub-parameters such as instrument parameters. In fact, every object or instrument will display some sort of parameter when selected. When you create any one of the instrument types, the default MIDI output or port that is given is zero. If the MIDI interface you own is multiport, like the Oneida 8, then any MIDI information played back at port 0 will be present at all 8 outputs. This is not always desirable. Now, although a very powerful multi-timbre keyboard, I'm using the Yamaha S80 as a single instrument controller. It's connected to port 1 of the Oneida. I'll select the instrument, and from the instrument parameters, I'll assign port USB 1 or Oneida Out 01 on the PC. I also need to set the transmit channel of the instrument to correspond with the receive channel on the S80 itself. The S80 is already set to 1, so I'll leave it. The transport window has a built-in MIDI indicator. I can verify that MIDI is being received by Logic, as well as being throughed and sent back to the Yamaha S80. The Yamaha will not receive any MIDI from Logic until I use the MIDI through tool to assign the instrument to the selected track, establishing the patch through. You hear the phase notes? That's because the SAD's local setting is turned on. Let me just cancel MIDI through by deactivating the track for record. Turn local off. Then re-establish patch through with the record button. There, that's much better. Multis are a little different. When initially setting them up, making parameter adjustments to the multi-instrument, including assigning a MIDI port, is done by selecting the entire multi. Click on the icon to do this. Ensuring that none of its sub-channels are selected, you assign the port in much the same way we did with the single instrument, via the multi's instrument parameters. But how many part multi-timbral is the synth or sampler? Currently, only the multi-instrument itself is visible in the flip menu. Well, in this case, the S5000 is 16 part. We tell Logic this by activating the sub-channels contained within the multi. Removing the diagonal dash indicates that the channel is active and available in the flip menu for use. You can see that all 16 channels of the Akai S5000 are now visible and ready to sequence with. Part of customizing your order load song is with icons and colors. They help to identify instruments and parts, especially once your song gets going. Once again, we'll use the instrument parameters to do this. Select the multi and choose an icon from the list. The dialog will ask if you want to apply the icon to all of the sub-channels. In this case, we do. Assigning color to a multi is done in the same manner as with icons. The color palette is located in the View menu. A similar dialog will ask if you desire the same color be applied to all the sub-channels. Don't forget that as you're sequencing, you can assign icons to specific instruments and patches, again, to make identification easier. Another way to create instruments is to import or copy them from existing songs. I'll open a song that came on the Logic Audio Support CD. It's called Various Multisets Version 4.0. When the open command is used, Logic will ask if you want to close or don't close the current song. The song contains a variety of multi-instruments from different keyboard manufacturers with the default patch names already typed in. You just need to locate the ones relevant to your virtual studio. I'll choose the Roland layer and select the multi-instrument for the JV2080. With the multi-instrument highlighted, I'll choose Copy from the Edit menu. After closing the song, I can simply paste the contents of the clipboard into the environment of the autoload. After checking the port assignment, it's immediately ready for use. If you don't want to use the copy and paste method, you can simply drag and drop instruments and objects from song to song. The mapped instrument is probably the most versatile of all instruments in that it does many things in different areas of the program. The great thing about a mapped instrument is that each note over the entire keyboard range can be named. The destination note of each individual key can also be changed, as well as how that note or key responds to velocity. In this example, a sequence is assigned to a single instrument on channel 10, not a mapped instrument. The drum part is playing a simple kick, snare, hi-hat, and cowbell pattern. If we look at the contents of the sequence in the event list editor, we can see that each key is displayed like normal, C1, D1, etc. If the track is replaced with a mapped instrument, all of the notes can now be viewed by actual drum names. This makes distinguishing certain parts, like all of the snares, easy to accomplish. Because this mapped instrument will represent channel 10 of the JV2080, just assign the port as normal, port 2. I'll make a copy of the mapped instrument by control or option dragging. I want this one to play channel 10 of the S5000. But instead of using direct port assignment, I'll use the existing S5000 multi-instrument as a conduit for the mapped instrument, sort of sharing the same port if you like. This is called cable port assignment. Simply cable the output of the mapped instrument directly to the multi-instrument. When this is done, a dialog will appear. This dialog simply tells us that the mapped instrument has a direct port assignment already established. The question is, do we want to keep or remove that existing port? Choosing no would cause any MIDI information played back on this mapped instrument to be routed out of two different places, port 2 and port 3. Choosing remove is the more appropriate operation. The mapped instrument's port is now off, and using the multi's port, 3. With no connection to your MIDI interface, either with direct or cable port assignment, the instrument, in a sense, becomes a dummy and has the same functionality as no output. The rest of the instruments in your studio should be configured with the same routine. Here, you can see that we've also finished setting up our virtual studio as far as the main synths and modules are concerned. I'll just locate the metronome from the transport. You'll find it in the clicks and ports layer by default. Let's move it to our MIDI instruments layer. Hold down the Option or Control key while selecting a destination layer. Set the click up using the MIDI clicks instrument parameters. Set the port, the downbeat note and velocity, as well as the quarter note click. I said earlier that you should give some thought to the patches you tend to reach for first when composing or producing music. Everybody has their favorite patches. In Logic, you can create your own set of custom instruments with their patches, volume, and pan settings already assigned and ready to go when clicked on. I've made a text object here in the MIDI instruments layer. It's only for organization though. I'm going to create normal, singular instruments. I'll cable one of them to the JV2080 and remove its default port. I'll change its channel to 15 using the mouse as a slider technique. I'll name it West Coast. I'll give it an icon, a bank message and a patch, and set the initial volume and pan. The program volume and pan settings will not be transmitted until the checkboxes are enabled. Now, do you see what I'm getting at? Once you've created them, it's like having a custom palette of sounds ready for making music. With the track selected, you can simply choose the MIDI through tool and click on the desired custom instrument. When this is done, all of the associated instrument parameters are transmitted and ready to play. You can see the MIDI indicator transmitting those settings as I drag the instrument from the environment to the track list. Once you've finished setting up your virtual studio, toggle the cables option found within the view menu of the environment to clean the window up. One of the last things to do is configure some simple screen sets. This will make a huge difference in navigating Logic once you begin to sequence music. Think of screen sets as memory locations for Windows. The screen set remembers the position, size, and zoom setting for quick and easy recall. A screen set will even remember which tool was selected in a particular window. To call up a screen set, use the numbers along the top of the QWERTY keyboard or the number keypad on the far right-hand side. There are 90 screen sets and the number 0 cannot be used. Let's go to our screen set 1 configuration. You can tell which screen set is currently being displayed by looking at the main menu bar for the screen set number. A screen set can be copied into the clipboard like this. I'll leave this screen set on the clipboard until later. I'll reconfigure screen set 1 to be my main working arrange window. This is where I'll do the majority of my sequencing. You can see just how easy it is to configure a screen set. Screen set 2 will be my event list editor. I also like to have an arrange window visible too. I'll tile the windows. I'll hide the parameters of the arrange window just to give me a little bit more working space. Screen set 3 will be the matrix editor. I'll close the open score window and choose open matrix from the main windows menu. You can of course use the pre-assigned key commands to do this. I'll go to the view menu and toggle the white background command. Then up to the main windows menu to open another arrange window. I'll tile the two horizontally this time. At screen set 4, I like to have access to the audio window and the arrange window. This allows me to quickly drag audio files from one window directly into the open arrangement. At screen set 5, I'll open the audio window by itself and zoom it to full screen. This is where I do the majority of my disk-related tasks, such as optimizing or deleting audio files. Now we're getting somewhere. In 6, I'll open the matrix to full zoom. To recall a double-digit screen set, such as 11, you hold down a modifier key while typing the desired screen set. The Mac is Control, the PC, Alt. Up at the Windows menu, I'll choose Paste Screen Set, and the one on the clipboard will be pasted to 11. Back at Screen Set 7, I'll make this the audio layer of the environment. It's the audio layer that's home to the audio object. I want to see the first 13 faders for my audio tracks. After cleaning up the window, I'll use the copy function to copy screen set 7 into the clipboard. Change to 8 and choose paste. I'll scroll the window so I can see the effects returns or any other desired audio object, including the audio instrument objects. Finally, at screen set 9, I'll open the track mixer. The track mixer is handy as it displays everything that is currently visible in the arrange window's track list. If I assign audio 32 to track 5, it's immediately available for adjustment in the track mixer. Before moving on to actual sequencing, let's recap on what we've done so far. We took a look at the audio drivers and all of the associated preferences, the default song and what it consists of, what the autoload song is and where it should be saved, we looked at the environment and how it relates to the arrange window. We also set up all of the instruments in our virtual environment studio, which included some custom instruments. We configured a total of 10 screen sets that will make navigation and editing within Logic much easier. It'll also give you a good starting point for creating your own. The only item left is to take a look at the user-definable key commands. The use of the definable key commands together with screen sets will help you achieve speed and precision for all of your sequencing and editing needs. You can open the key commands using the main options menu under settings. Take some time to read them, there are many, but don't worry, you only need a few. The rest will come naturally, a bit like riding a bike. Key commands are separated into groups. You can see the different groups when you scroll the window. They're highlighted in black. Global commands are commands that work throughout the program regardless of the window type you're in. Play, stop, and record are all examples of global commands. The various window commands are common throughout the different types of windows, such as the arrange, the event list editor, or the matrix editor. The zoom commands correspond to functions found in these various windows. The parameters are another example. Typing the letter H in these various windows will hide or show the parameters. As we scroll towards the end of the list, the key commands become more specific to functions that can only be performed in single windows. To assign a new key command to a function, you first have to locate the command you wish to modify and select it. Click the Learn button and type the keystroke, F8. It's that simple. If we now locate signature changes from the Options menu, we can see the newly defined keystroke assigned next to the function. By the way, when you come across key commands with bullet points, it's an indication that those key commands are only available as key commands. Don't go searching every Logic Audio menu looking for them, they're not to be found. Once you become more familiar with Logic Audio terms and some of the menu items, you can use the key commands Find function. Activate the Find button or click in the white box and type in a keyword. When you press Return, Logic will display all of the key commands containing that word. Assign the keystroke, and if the one you press is already used, you'll be warned. Deactivate the Find function and locate the conflicting key command. Hit the Delete or Backspace key to clear its keystroke. Turn off the Learn key and close the window. Hitting Spacebar from this point on will activate the Toggle Record function. It's a personal choice, but I like to assign single keystrokes. It means I don't have to press a modifier key. If I'm working a session, I select the sequence and hit the single keystroke. S is solo, L is toggle loop, and to create a new track, the letter N. By exploring the possibilities of a custom autoload song, you really start to concentrate on the creative aspect of making music. Everything's at your fingertips, so Logic becomes an extension of your creativity. Every time you launch Logic Audio, a copy of your custom order load template will open, ready to assist with the only task at hand, making your music happen. We hope you've enjoyed this video and learned a lot about the basic technique of Logic Audio. My name is Phil Jackson. This is Gear Vision. Come and see us on the web at gearvision.com. Until next time, happy sequencing.
Now that you've seen Volume 1, be sure to check out Volume 2, Recording and Editing MIDI. See the technique for recording, applying real-time playback parameters, manipulating objects, folders, the matrix editor, and much more. Watch as Phil takes the autoload song you've just created and tweaks the screen sets into powerful editing tools. Be sure to reserve your copy today. Gear Vision would like to say thank you to the following companies.